لا إله إلا الله، إن الحمد لله نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقواتنا ما أحييتنا، اللهم واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، وانصرنا اللهم على من عادانا. اللهم ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا. اللهم ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك ولا يرحمنا يا رب العالمين. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم، إن زلزلة الساعة شيء عظيم، يوم ترونها تذهل كل مرضعة عما أرضعت، وتضع كل ذات حمل حملها، وترى الناس سكارى وما هم بسكارى ولكن عذاب الله شديد. وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيدنا محمد بن عبد الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه وعنا معهم إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، in the name of Allah سبحانه وتعالى, the most compassionate, the most merciful, all praise and thanks are due to him, and peace and blessings be upon his beloved Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. He who is guided by the will of Allah, no one can misguide him. And he who is misguided, no one can guide him except Allah سبحانه وتعالى. I do bear witness that there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his messenger. Our title for the khutbah today basically is, how close is Islam from Canadian? Is it close or far from them? Or why, another title, please, why not to let them know about Islam? The reason for this khutbah, basically, a few months ago, I was driving my car. So I stopped by the traffic light. There was a truck in front of me. Sometimes you wait maybe 2 or 3 minutes on the traffic light. So your eyes start looking at anything. So I was trying to read, so I noticed that there is something written on the truck in front of me. The exact statement that was written on the track was the following: nothing takes priority over safety. I repeat, nothing takes priority over safety. You know, sometimes your mind starts working by its own. You can't stop it. So I read the statement, nothing takes priority over safety. Immediately, the following meaning came to my mind. When I read this statement, it was, I think, my 7th or 8th month in this country. Still, relatively, I was new. So my mind alone started recalling all related topics and materials. You know, in the internet, we have what they call the hyperlinks. So my mind started working like the hyperlinks. It started bringing all related things to the area of safety. I remembered many people told me that safety is first in this country, which is true. I started now relating this to something I was at that time doing, which was I was preparing myself for the full G license. So I was reading in the book, you know, preparing myself for license. And as you know, most of you drive. You know the amazing restrictions you have on the traffic system. And when you go on the street, you can read this kind of signs. If your speed was over the limit with 50 kilometers of speed, you are entitled to pay up to $10,000 and 6 points from your license, and you might go to jail up to 2 years, and your car will be seized. I was reading this. And I was preparing myself for the exam. If I did not stop by the flashing sign of the school bus, may God be with me. Because I'm lost. You know that. If I did not reduce my speed, what I'm talking about, basically all of our, these laws, they are put for the sake of what? Safety, which is true. So my mind started recalling the traffic system that I'm studying because I want to sit for the exam. I started recalling all the people around me. They told me safety is first. For example, they told me about a system that I'm not aware of this country. I don't know what they call the institution. This kind of take care of the children. If anyone calls the telephone by phone, that I witnessed my neighbor hitting his child or abusing the children, what will happen to him in this country? In a few minutes, not hours. Am I exaggerating? Few minutes, literally, someone will come and they will investigate on spot immediately, and there is a big possibility the child could be taken on spots. True or false? For the sake of safety, security. They want to secure the children, not to be abused, which is good, nice. So I'm telling you about what my mind is starting, you know, bringing to me when I read this statement. Then I started remembering, they told me, be careful, you have to remove the snow from the front of your house. Really, but why should I? Don't I have the freedom because my house? No, you are not free not to remove the snow. You must remove it because it's a slippery area and you're responsible in that. If someone got hurt, you will be in a big trouble legally. Really? Yes. Don't I have the freedom not to clean my house? No. But is not this is a free country? Limits. Because safety is first, security is first. Wow, nice. I love it, by the way. I like it. Good. So my mind still bringing to me the stories that I heard about. I remembered going to a public park. There was an instruction, you know, area inside the park. It was completely secured with fence. And I read the following sign, literally, it says, it's completely prohibited, this word, prohibited for any worker in this site to be in the site without having the helmet, the vest, the boots. It's prohibited against the law. You are not allowed, but okay, I want to work, but I'm free. This is my body. Don't interfere with my body. I want to get hurt. No, you are not allowed. You must, even we will protect you from yourself. Wow. So from an angle, amazing. So what is the core point? Safety, security. Well, by the way, what I told you came to my mind in seconds. You know, the mind, you know, the speed, like this, you know? So just something like a flash in my mind. I said, SubhanAllah, isn't this exactly Islam? Isn't Islam completely designed to protect us and to save us from everything that is prohibited in Islam? What's the difference? What is the difference? So my mind started comparing alone by itself. I was not aiming to that. I was just waiting, you know, just the traffic light to start. I said, SubhanAllah, thinking about the law of the traffic, or any many other laws, at least what I knew, the traffic, the snow, the child care, the problems. They told me in Alberta, for example, I don't know, for example, the people they are allowed, if you want to go hunting, to have their, for example, guns or something, but with amazing restrictions. Should be closed, it should be in the, you know, the behind the car, it should not be open if the police car, so it's just restrictions, teachings, regulations, the law, by law, the fine, prohibited, you are not allowed or something, which is excellent. That's why we have one of the lowest here in Canada, lowest degrees of car accident, one of the lowest rates on earth in the problems of gangs, which is excellent because they have put a lot of things secure the people, because as we read, nothing takes priority over safety. So I'm comparing that, which is excellent. Now we are living in this country. I came up with the results. I think I'm not exaggerating, metaphorically speaking, if I said that safety and security is the religion, the official religion of Canada. Safety. Everything, be careful. Safety first, safety first, safety, which is excellent. I love it, by the way. I love it. Okay, let's see. How close is Islam from this? Why? I'm giving you now a way how to introduce your great Islam in this system. Al-khamr, alcohol, it's prohibited. Why? You know, Allah has revealed in the Quran it's haram. Okay, why? Explain to the people. Explain to yourself. Explain to your kids before. Fix it in your mind. Allah wanted to make your life safety. Allah, you know, basically, what makes me a human being and not less than any animal, basically, when I lose my mind? What does alcohol make with me? It pushes me to lose the power of intellect somehow, completely or partly. It depends on how much I have drunk. But nevertheless, if I'm fully drunk, I lost this. What can I do when I lose this? I think you agree with me, and you know, at least let's go to our neighbor, our dear neighbor, United States of America. They are the best country on earth in statistics. The best. On anything. They do statistics on anything. So go and just search Hajj Google. Ask him about the, you know, the relation between alcohol and car accidents and death, you know, cases in the United States. I'm not saying reason number one, but one of the top reasons with heart attacks, thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands on the world. But I say the United States because they have statistics. We can say, for example, in California, XYZ, such and such. We can say in, you know, in northern states, in southern states, because they do have statistics. Tens of thousands on yearly basis, they lose their lives and they kill others because they were, they have drunk and they drive. Car accidents, damages with billions, not with millions. And, you know, insurance companies, they work. Alcohol companies work, insurance companies work, okay? All other things works, and some people, they lose their lives. They kill each other because they are drinking this. In Islam, one word, okay? Fajtanibu. That's it. How great Islam is. Two, why, for example, I'll give examples here that came to my mind. Riba, interest, why it's haram? Why? Simply to save you and to save me from the vampires. So as not to let the people of the banks, the bankers, to enslave us. This is the whole idea of riba. Give me the money, you return just the money with interest. All the money with him, I have a money, you have a money. We have an extra money. We give the money to the bank. The bank take the money from us, and we became lazy waiting for the interest rate and to extra our money. And we are not working. We are just waiting for the money to be increased. Now, the bank gives to majority of the people who are in need with interest. They don't care whether he failed or not. They don't care whether he's honest or not. They care. The money should be returned back. So this idea was haram because money was created for the sake of being exchanged with either benefits or goods or donation. Money itself should not be an item to be sold. It's haram. It's for the exchange. If I have the power of muscles, you need me to protect you as a security guard. I'm equal to you, but I don't have. You have a money, I have the power of muscle. So we are equal. We work together. I have the power of intellect. I'm expert, for example, in computer, for example. You need me, I need you. You have the money, I have the know-how. We open a special center for training. We failed both. You lose your money, I lose my efforts. But in the banking interest system, the one who has the money will enslave others. They will lose their security. They will lose their safety. That's why riba is haram. Why, for example, zina, adultery, fornication, why it's haram? Why? Simply, it wants to save the society from the psychological destruction. When I don't know to whom I belong, what kind of human being I will be. Zina means by default destruction for family system. zina by default means some few millions will be not aware who their fathers are. The loss of the connection, loss of loyalty. So the best solution for me is to commit suicide and to leave this world. And go and search and ask what is the highest rate of suicide committing in Europe. Compare it with an amazing fact that the majority of this country who has this highest rate of suicide committing, they have the highest rate of illegitimate children. 52 people of this country, they don't know who are their fathers, according to the BBC. X country in Europe. One out of each two in the street, if you stopped him, excuse me, sir, hi, how are you? Who's your father? I don't know. 52%. Why? That's why zina is haram. It destroys families. Why zina is haram? Let's look around ourselves, basically. How thousands of people, they are collecting and saving their money from the age of 30 up to age of 30, I don't know what they call it, RSAP or something like that. RSP? No, but they want to save the money to take care of themselves after they are retired, which is good. But wait, no one is asking where is the family? Where is the extended family? Where is 15, 20, 15, 25, 30 grandchildren? Where are they? They don't exist. Are you with me? Just to know how great Islam is for human beings, even if they don't believe in it, by the way. I'm not talking about necessarily to believe in Islam. Just apply it. You will enjoy it. Wallahi, just apply it. Apply the system, this system. We are in a secular country. We are applying part of its system, and we feel happy in many aspects compared with other countries. We don't believe in some certain aspect, yet we are enjoying part of its aspect. The same thing, make a comparison. Many non-Muslims can enjoy their life if they apply the system of Islam, even if they don't believe in God, which is the basic minimum of khair that they can achieve. So when you compare it, is not Islam is all about safety when you talk about why hijab? Why the hijab is fard? Why is it compulsory? To save chastity, purity, naqa, tahara, to save it, not to let anyone. All the people on earth, they are suffering from sexual assault, sexual harassment, verbal sexual harassment, some, oh, wherever you go. Wherever you go. Why khalwa is haram? You know the term khalwa in Islam? Khalwa, it's an Islamic term, means it's fully prohibited for a male Muslim to stay in one place with a female, okay, alone, in a closed place, if they are not from the maharim, if she's not his wife or mother or sister or aunt or etc. It's prohibited. It's called khalwa. But the fact that I'm sitting in a room with a girl or with a woman, she is foreigner from me. Foreigner, it's like expression to means that I'm allowed legally to marry her. It's called ajnabiyya. If I'm allowed to marry her, unless she is not my wife, it's haram for me to stay in one place with her in a closed place, khalwa. Okay, it's haram. But Sheikh, I don't have any bad intention, wallahi. Even if you don't have bad intention, for the sake of security of the society, to save everyone, not any problem that could happen, which is already happening all over the world. This is Islam. So all of these meanings came to me while I was just waiting in the traffic lights. Then the last message that came to my mind after I started reflecting upon of this, the most important thing that we have in Islam, and the people, they must know it. As long as safety is their concern, they must know it. We have an added value in Islam. What is the added value? All worldly systems, like Canadian one, which is one of the best, if not the best, they secure and give you safety in this worldly life. But unfortunately, they have no access to the hereafter. No relation. We have an added value. Our added value, if I may put it metaphorically, if you played the game according to the correct rules and you plugged your plug into the socket correctly and you did it in the proper way as God wants, you will have a safe life in the hereafter as well. And this is the added value of Islam. أقول قولي هذا. استغفر الله لي ولكم فيا فوز المستغفرين. استغفر الله العظيم الذي لا إله إلا هو حي قيوم أتوب إليه. استغفر الله العظيم الذي لا إله إلا هو حي قيوم أتوب إليه. استغفر الله العظيم. اللهم أنت استغفر. إن الحمد لله نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد يحيي ويميت وهو على كل شيء قدير. Now, to conclude, why I decided to give this khutbah. As I told you, the trigger was the statement on the truck. Why I decided to give it for many reasons. Reason number one, please, please be proud of your Islam. Two, please do your best to let the nice Canadians around you know about Islam. Let them know and let them see Islam in you. Or otherwise, I might be committing a crime against Allah's gifts because they don't know. They don't know. Let them know. If they love safety and security, they have to know because we have a, it's okay, take it from marketing point of view. You have an excellent item. You know it. They don't know it. Common sense, what should you do? Do marketing. Tell them about it. It's not your business if they accept or refuse, not yours. ليس عليك هداهم. But it's your business to do the marketing. It's your business, it's your duty. It's a compulsory, by the way. It's a compulsory fard on you and me, all of us. We have to market Islam. They must know in terms of knowledge and they must see in terms of the application. Unfortunately, I know, you know, we know that unfortunately, they have a good percentage of us, they don't represent the good Islam. Unfortunately, this is a reality. At least let the rest of us, 10%, 15%, 20%, I don't know how. Let's imagine they are just 15% who are practicing Islam. Let this 15% of practicing Muslims, let the majority around us know about the beauty of Islam, the truth of Islam, the amazing messages of Islam and see how great effort or great influence we could be making in this place, inshallah. Now, the other reason. Now, I think the majority of us came to this country. I will take it from completely ethical human sense now. Can you imagine someone who's welcoming you in his country? Most of us, we came as guests. Most of us, they enjoy a better life than theirs, in their countries, I mean. Most, not all, but most. The least of ethical, okay, exchanging gifts. They offered you something nice. Give them the best of what you have. This is the best. Because you will give an added value. The added value there, in the hereafter as well. It's not just here. So they gave you something you don't have it in your country, which is for most of us. But you have something they don't have it. Give it to them. Let them have an idea about it. By this, you will be a great successor in this worldly life and in the hereafter. Before I finish and I start my dua, I want just to remind you in case. You know, in this blessed masjid, mashallah, each Friday after Isha, they have a special halaqa. Today, if Allah wills, inshallah, I will be giving the halaqa, inshallah, tonight after Isha at 7:30 in this masjid. And the title will be about trying to refute the doubt about why Allah is not responding for me as an individual, even though I'm a good and nice Muslim and person. I have a lot of troubles in my life. I do suffer from lots. I'm not falling in short. I do my best to do the best. And I call Allah and I ask Allah in many things in my life with regard to my son and my daughter and something, but Allah is not responding to me. What is the problem? How can I solve this problem? How can I guarantee to... How can I... لا لا لا. لا لا. عفوا. How can I... Sorry. How can I guarantee... I forgot what I was saying. Guarantee what?
About somebody suffering.
Ah. How can I guarantee that Allah will respond to me according to Islamic rules, inshallah, after Salat al-Isha, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept us alive, inshallah? اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا وعافنا واعف عنا، اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا يا رب العالمين، اللهم ارحمنا فوق الأرض وتحت الأرض ويوم العرض عليك يا حي يا قيوم يا كريم. اللهم ارزقنا الإخلاص في قول والعمل يا رب العالمين. اللهم إنا عبيدك أبناء عبيدك أبناء إمائك، نواصينا بيدك، ماض فينا حكمك، عدل فينا قضاؤك. نسألك بكل اسم هو لك سميت به نفسك أو أنزلته في كتابك أو علمته أحدا من خلقك أو استأثرت به في الغيب عندك، أن تجعل القرآن العظيم ربيع قلوبنا وجلاء أحزاننا وذهاب همومنا وغمومنا يا رب العالمين. إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. وأقم الصلاة. في هذا من حفظ القرآن هنا يحفظ صوته جيد. Do we have حافظ here who memorized the Quran who can't take the imama instead of me? Fish.